Thank you, Pierluigi, and thank you, Graziano, for being with us. So a few words on Graziano Pesole, who obviously does not deserve any presentation since he's one of our most important people in bioinformatics in Italy. So Graziano Pesole received a degree in chemistry at the University of Bari in April 1983, and then after a long and very fruitful experience in industry and academy, in 2002 he was appointed full professor of molecular biology at the Department of Biomolecular Science and Biotechnology in Milan. Then, in 2005, he moved to the University of Bari, Molecular Biology and Department of Biochemistry at the University of Bari. Since then, he is working and giving important contribution, and in 2010 became also director of the Institute of Biomembranes, Bioenergetics and Molecular Biotechnology at the CNR in Bari, till a few years ago. And what is most noticeable about Graziano Pesole is that he, for his achievements and scientific successes, became head of node of the Italian Elixir branch since the very beginning in 2010. He's presently a group leader of a very active team that is mainly interested in bioinformatics, comparative genomics, molecular evolution as a major topics of research, whose results include, I should say, important and famous bioinformatics tool for computational analysis of genomes and transcriptomes. Focuses are molecular evolution and computational approaches, and more recently, genome assembly annotation, transcriptome profiling, detection of functional sensing of disease causative mutation, ChIP-seq analysis, RNA editing, metagenomics, and whatever else he will tell us. Thank you, Graziano, for taking your time, precious time, and being with us. The mic is yours.
Okay, thank you very much to Rita, to Gigi. They are very nice colleagues and friends, and it is a pleasure for me to give this presentation that, as you can see from the title, would like to give you an update on the evolution of the SARS-CoV-2 virus, just looking at its genomic features. So briefly, the next slide shows you which is the outline of my presentation. So I will start with a brief introduction on evolution and viruses, because as you know, viruses have a quite peculiar evolution. Then I will provide you some few details on coronaviruses, and then on the disease that they induce, that is COVID-19, and so the effect, as you know, of the different variants that time to time we have to face. Then I will stress the importance of the genomic surveillance and the hunt that we do for new variants in order to understand and assess the functional impact. And finally, I will describe you the tool that we devised for the identification and prioritization of emerging variants. So viruses are really very interesting objects in the sense that they are not in sensu stricto living organisms because they are not autonomous, but they have experienced, as you can see here, a tremendous adaptive evolution process since the origin of life. So they have really experienced an enormous extent of evolution. And this has made them really able to successfully infect all living organisms, from prokaryotes you know very well phages to eukaryotes. This is because they have a very high mutation rate and the different strategies they adopt to maintain their genetic information. So when we talk about the genetic information, all of you maybe think of the DNA, which is contained in the cellular nucleus. In some cases, we may have RNA, but as you can see in this slide, viruses can use 7 different ways to store the genetic information, as you can see here. So really they exploited a different forms of maintaining the genetic information. So as you can see from double-strand DNA, that is the conventional way to maintain the genetic information, to single-strand DNA, double-strand RNA, single-strand RNA in the plus or minus orientation, a hybrid of single-strand plus with DNA, and also gapped double-strand DNA. In our case, as you will see in a moment, SARS-CoV-2 use the single-strand plus RNA as for storage of the genetic information. So, as you know very well, viruses are obligate intracellular parasites. So they can reproduce only when they are hosted in a cell. And each virus has a specific host range, and so a limited number of host cells that it can infect. So concerning the way a virus can evolve, we have just 3 different modalities. One is the genetic drift. That is that some strains, some types, are more successful than others just to chance effect, or in other words, what we call founder effect. The second mechanism is gene flow. This is particularly important when the virus genome is split in several fragments and can happen when 2 viruses infect a cell at the same time, and so they can swap across them the genetic material. This is the way, for example, that evolved the flu strain of viruses. And the third and most important way of virus evolution is natural selection. And this natural selection, in this case, is particularly important just due to the high mutation rate that all viruses can experience, and then can drive a very important process of natural selection. And in this case, of course, adaptive evolution is a very important mechanism. So different from macroscopic organisms, viral phenotypes cannot be observed directly. So the only way to analyze and observe the effect of natural selection is to observe this indirectly from the study of the genomes. So by looking at the genomes and performing comparative analysis of the genomes, what we can observe are 1 very highly conserved region which never change. So if these regions are very conserved, this means that there is a purifying selection in action. So mutations are skipped out. And so these are the regions when we observe conservation. But we also observe some regions, some sites, which are very variable and change at a very high rate. And so this is the effect of diversifying selection. And in this place, we have innovation. So we have two different forces that drive the evolution of viruses that balance conservation and innovation. A third mechanism is convergence. When there is a character which confers a specific advantage, it can arise different times and so fix it independently. And so this is the effect of convergent evolution. And due to the high mutation rates of viruses, we can really observe evolution at work in this kind of organism. So what about coronaviruses? As I told you before, they are a diverse family of viruses which use single-strand plus RNA that are able to infect a wide range of avian and mammalian hosts. We have that bats, rodents, and birds may act as the natural reservoir for many coronaviruses, but they can also experience some expansion in other hosts. And this, unfortunately, is the history that we experienced in the last 2 years, when there is what we call a spillover from the reservoir species to the human host. And as you can see here, in the case of SARS-CoV-2, the highest similarity has been observed, as you know very well, with a bat specimen that share over 96% of sequence identity. So this is the reason why we believe that the spillover was from a bat specimen, even if, as you can see, there is some similarity with a pangolin SARS-CoV strain, and also we have also the similarity that you know with SARS-CoV-1, MERS, and other common cold SARS-CoV that, as you know, is the very common in as a cold cause in human. And below you can see some figures about this virus. So the diameter is about 100 nanometers. And you can see the typical form with this corona, which is made by this spike protein that we will show in a moment. So concerning the genome is quite long with respect to other viruses. That is about 30 kilobase. Is a linear RNA genome, which encode for a total of about 30 proteins, of which 16 are encoded by two large overlapping ORF that are called ORF1A, B, and ORF1B. And they are very common in human and animals, and are the cause of cold, as I told you before, but in general of all upper respiratory infections. All known human coronaviruses are animal origins, with an important role for domestic animals with a role as intermediate host. As you can see in these slides, as I told you before, this is the large ORF1, where we have a frame shift that can generate the longer form or the shorter form that give rise to a large number of non-structural proteins, including the RDRP, that is RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, which is the key enzyme for the propagation of the virus in the host cell. And then in color, you can see the structural protein, which the famous spike protein, which is the protein that form the so-called corona of this, of the virus particle. As you can see in the below, the spike protein is recognized by a human receptor protein, which mediate the engulfment of the virus particle in the human cell with the consequent release of the virus genome that is so replicated and can give rise to new particles of virus that go to infect other cells and so start the infection process. As you know very well, we are still experiencing this pandemic, which started at the end of 2019 with first outbreak start in China in the Wuhan region, and the official declaration of pandemics, as you know, was declared by the World Health Organization on March 11, 2020. As to yesterday, we had about 500 million cases in the world and over almost 6 million deaths. And you can see here the plot with the time span of the infection incidence across the world. So why is important to establish the so-called SARS-CoV-2 genomic surveillance? This is critical and crucial to understand the evolution of this virus. Because when we compare genomes emerged at different times in different countries, on one end, we can identify novel strain, but also we identify key features of adaptive evolution, which of course may have functional implication. And in this case, the comparative analysis can be done very well because we have a large wealth of data. To date, we have over 7 million genomic sequences available to do our analysis. As you know, all of us are very well aware of the so-called variants, even if the terminology was not mentioned at the beginning of the pandemic. But the first variant was very important. And you can see here in this slide, emerged very quickly and was a change for aspartate to glycine in position 614 of the spike protein, which involved a much higher infectivity with this mutation. And the functional assessment of this mutation, which became really highly prevalent worldwide, was assayed by Korber and al. In a paper published in Cell in 2020, where they found that this allele variant conferred an increased capacity to infect the cells about one order of magnitude higher. In fact, all current variants of SARS-CoV-2 now carry this mutation. And this is the mechanism of accumulation of new mutation that progressively confer new variants. We know that these variants confer this advantage, selective advantage, just looking at the spread of the mutation. As you can see in the slide, we have that the frequency, the rate of occurrence of the mutant strain substituted completely in short time the former one. By the way, this particular mutation has been observed prevalently outside China, even if we have evidence that it arose in China, probably in January, February, because we have some genome sequence there that demonstrate this, but not in one. And so this is another interesting observation. So as I told you, because these mutations are very relevant, because they change the affinity of the interaction between the spike protein and the receptor. And so they increase significantly the efficiency of the infection. And the human receptor, as you know very well, is this ACE2 receptor that is the so-called gateway for the coronavirus entrance in the human cell. So all mutations that change the structure of the this particular region of the spike protein may have very important effect on the infection rate. So now we can just briefly discuss how we do identify dangerous variants. So by the way, as I have shown briefly before, this is done mostly retrospectively. So we observe the rate of increase of new variants in different geographical regions. And the variants are classified with respect to their impact on the pandemic. So at the moment, we have four classes of variants that are class one are called VOC, that means variant of concern. That means that they have significant impact on the three aspects that are important to classify the variants. So these three aspects are: one, transmissibility; two, severity of the disease; and three, escape of the immune response. In total, we had four VOC, currently three, because one of them, the so-called alpha variant, is no more present across the world. The second class are the so-called VOI, that are variants of interest that can have a potential impact on transmissibility, severity, and immunity. And this is based on mostly on genomic data, not epidemiological data. In total, there are five, and currently we have three. Then we have the so-called candidate to be attentioned, the so-called VUM, variant under monitoring. In this case, we have weak evidence of a potential epidemiological impact, and so these are to be monitored. And in total, we have 27, and currently we have none which are still circulating. But the large majority of variants are in the class others, because they do not show any a significant advantage with respect to the original one strain of the virus. So we have in this class more than 1,500 variants of this type. So a variant is not a single mutation, of course, but is a constellation of mutation which collectively confer a specific shift of the properties of the viruses. And so you can see in these slides, for instance, in blue, the alpha variant, in orange, the beta, in yellow, the gamma, and in green, the delta, which the constellation of variants, which of course, as I said before, change the affinity with the human receptor, which clinical impact for transmissibility, pathogenicity, and risk of immune escape. And as I told you before, we in total observed 5 VOX. At the moment, we have only few circulating because, as you know very well, now the most circulating variant is Omicron, as you can see in this slide. So you can see here a time course for the pandemic in Italy, and you can see the different variants in different colors. In the first phase of the pandemic, numbers were very low, but then emerged the so-called alpha variant that at the beginning was called the English variants. Then we had some increase and rapid decrease of the gamma, but we had the Delta variants, that was the so-called Indian variants, and now we have the so-called Omicron variants, which is represent more or less 100% of variants circulating in Italy and in all the world. As I told you before, a single mutation does not change significantly the property of a virus. And what you can see here are mutation in 3 protein, ORF1A, ORF1B, and spike. And I want to bring your attention to the lower panel where we have the spike protein. The first row refer to the Omicron variants. And you can see that the number of mutations that characterize this variant is really very high with respect to the other variants. So luckily enough, these new variants, as you know, has a very strong infectivity, but this is not reflected in the clinical outcome and also in the immune properties. So now we go how we can identify and classify new variants. So we can have, for carrying this job, different strategies that we can use to classify variants. This is done with computational tools, which need to be not only accurate, but also efficient, because as you told you before, the number of genomes to be scrutinized is very high, as well as the number of variants. At the moment, the state-of-the-art tool is called Pango, which use a kind of phylogenetic classification. Then we have the Nextstrain tool, which is the one that is in the GSAID portal for accessing the genome of the virus. And we also proposed a complementary method that we called Aplocov, which has been published last year. And in that, in our opinion, can complement the Pango method, which is the state-of-the-art method that is currently used by the World Health Organization. So you can see here the differences, also because different methods produce different strain, different type of variants. And you can see that Nextstrain, GSAID, and Pango are very different. For instance, at the moment, Pango propose over 1000 virus lineages, but as I told you before, only very, very few are relevant and are classified as VOC, VOI, or VUM. And in all these cases, the variants are defined based on the phylogeny, that is the evolutionary history of the virus, of the virus. That, of course, as you may understand, become more and more complicated as the number of available genome increase across time. So at the moment, as I told you before, Pango is currently the gold standard method because as an higher granularity with respect to Nextstrain and GSA is better than tracking, but is less robust to noise because, you know, to dealing with the phylogeny of million genomes is not an easy task. So what we observe looking at SARS-CoV-2 genomes. So we clearly observe that this virus has a low level of variability, about 1.8 for 10 times minus 3 substitution per site per year. And you can see in the plot below, in red, SARS-CoV-2 with respect to blue SARS-CoV-1. So SARS-CoV-2 evolves slower than SARS-CoV-1. We have about 0.55 polymorphic sign between pairs of neighbor genomes. We observe over 200,000 distinct allele variants, but the large majority of this has a very, very low global prevalence, as you can see in the plot on the right in blue. So this plot reports the number of genomes carrying the allele with respect to the percentage of genomes carrying that allele. And so you can see that the alleles with a prevalence above 1% are very, very rare. And so these are the ones which are relevant for the evolution of the virus. In addition, we also observe a quite high rate of recombination. So what about our method for tracking new variants? So our method is very, very simple. First, we just consider those variants which have, in this case for variants, I intend alleles, which have a prevalence above 1%. Not only this, but also those alleles that not only are above 1% of prevalence, but which persist for at least 30 days. Then we define a variant if they are separated by at least two group-specific alleles. So one haplogroup should have at least two sites in linkage. Then we analyze the data with geographic level granularity in the sense that we can observe specific prevalence locally, not worldwide. So in this way, we can immediately assess if a new variant is and is rapidly fixed in a specific geographic area. The advantage of this method is stable and can be easily integrated in other systems. So it can be really complementary. And this method has been published last year in molecular biology and evolution, and can be used for, as I told you before, to prioritize new variants and predict eventually new dangerous variants. Going back to the problem of genome surveillance, we should be really aware that we can discover, identify, and then characterize new variants only if we carry out a pervasive genomic surveillance. That means that we sequence a substantial fraction of positive samples, and this sequencing should be done in an homogeneous way, both at the geographic level, covering all countries, and in temporal level, so progressively across time. But as you may very easily understand, the genome surveillance is very heterogeneous in different countries, and most of the countries do not follow the WHO recommendation to sequence at least 5% of positive samples. And this is particularly true for low-income countries or for other countries which do not have suitable sequencing facilities. And the last problem, but not least, is data sharing, because we can follow the evolution of the virus only and only if the data are shared and are open. And this is another very big problem. Probably only 25% of the genome are make available to the scientific community. So this is a very important limitation. And so missing data may mean that we may miss very relevant bok, boy, or boom. And this is really an issue, and has been really an issue in this long pandemic. And as you can see in this slide, we have a very, very strong sampling bias, because considering the genomes, over 50% of the data comes from two countries, that is UK and US. Collectively, over 70% comes from EU, and only less than 5% data are from Africa. So this is really a problem, and has been a problem in order to trace dangerous variants tempestively. Going back to the classification system, as I told you before, we have followed the evolution of the virus since the beginning. And as you can see, back in January 2020, we just observed 12 haplogroups, starting from what we call AG1, that is the one strain of the virus. Then in a year later, the haplogroup was increased to 66, with over 100 novel mutations fixed. And the year later, number of haplogroups tremendously increased to over 1,000, with over 1,000 novel mutations. Why I am showing you this plot? Yes, because the virus continues to evolve despite our possible hope. So now people are talking about reopening everything, to remove masks, and so on. Of course, we are now a very strong weapon against this virus, that is the vaccine, but until the virus will be circulating across the world, we cannot exclude, but instead we can say we may give this from granted that new variants will arise, and we cannot know which will be the properties and the functional features of this new variant. So until the virus circulated is sustained across the world, we cannot predict too much. But as I told you before, we have now the vaccine, which is a very important protection against this infection. So, a virus strain becomes relevant when it is fixed. But when a specific virus strain becomes prevalent, it may have some specific features. So the really important task is how can functionally annotate mutation. So what is the predicted effect of this mutation? Is the mutation, for instance, recurrent? So we observe it in different lineages. Is it associated with known functional elements? But if we identify new potential interesting mutation, we can also carry out experimental validation. So we can do this experimentation in vitro on cell lines, infecting cells with these new strains in order to assess and evaluate possible effects. Of course, bioinformatics can help us a lot in the sense that computer algorithms can predict and evaluate the effect of mutation in silico. And last year we published a tool that is called CORGAT that provides a very rich annotation of new genomes. And this is rich because we include in the annotation, for instance, not only the knowledge of replacement mutation, the knowledge of the structural important regions of the proteins of the virus, but we also include regulatory elements, epitopes, prevalence, and so on, in order to provide a rich provision of metrics which can help researchers in order to assess the effect of the virus. So in this slide, you can see a very simple snapshot of CORGAT in the sense that we measure evidence of selection, of positive selection. We measure the presence of mutation in epitopes. We annotate mutation in relevant functional domains and also the prevalence rate in the different geographic regions. So we can have in this way an array of features that can be used to provide simple metrics of the virus properties. So what is very, really interesting, if we look at this plot, we have dimension reduction of the features of the virus. And so each strain, each variant is a dot in this plot. You can see that VOC, that are the dangerous isoform of the virus, which are the red dot, are all clustered in a single region of the plot. And this what means? This means that all the VOC variants, but not only VOC, but also, as you can see, VOC, BOI, and VU, are share some features in common. So we have a very simple way to predict in advance strains which may have some relevant features, considering the epidemic features of the virus. Just to show you an example of the features that allow us to predict relevant variants, you can see in these three plots a clear significant difference, for instance, of in some features in the fact that dangerous variants have an excess of mutation associated to viral epitopes. They have an excess in mutation under positive selection. They have an excess of missense substitution and so on. And so putting together all of these features, we were able to integrate all of them in a linear score, which provide a measure of the dangerousness of a new viral strain. And with a simple threshold score, we identify over 87% of dangerous variants flagged by international health authorities, plus some new ones with similar mutation profile, which are not flagged by health authorities, but could be worth of some attention. One of these is, for instance, the WHOM variant C.1.2, which first observed in May 2021, but became WHOM some months later. Our system was able to prioritize it in about 1 second. So just to give you the advantage of a system like this. Look at the Delta variants. This became dominant in the world in November 21, first detected in India in late 2020, but become dominant worldwide by June 2021, and was dominant because more transmissible, over 200% more transmissible than the original strains. More than 4 million genomes and more than 150 subvariants. We found that some of them, of the mutation, were associated to higher infectivity, and we identified across these over 150 subtypes a further subtype with 10 additional subtypes, 10 additional non-synonymous mutation in the spike protein, which became quickly highly prevalent in Netherlands and North Europe, which is has been now replaced by Omicron, but of course this variant deserved some attention by health authorities, as you may understand very well. And you can see this very clearly in this plot, when you can see the prevalence across time of Delta and this one new one that we call the Delta Plus. And you can see that we could carry out some very simple Fisher test to measure the faster rate with respect to Delta, and this is so, as well as the resilience with respect to Omicron. And as you can see, for instance, in Norway, Sweden, and Denmark, we had an higher resilience of Delta Plus with respect to Omicron, that now, of course, replaced both forms of the Delta variants. Now we have worldwide a clear predominance of the Omicron variants, which is about 70 times faster than Delta, but luckily enough, it stopped its action in higher lung airways. This implies a less severe disease, but as you can see here, the difference in the spike in red mutation between Delta and Omicron, you can see that as a total of 60 mutations with respect to the reference variants, that confer, of course, as I told you before, a very higher infectivity, but also a better evasion of the immune system. This is the reason why we experienced the third vaccine dose, so the booster, that is was really highly recommended to face this new variant type. Of course, Omicron does not stop evolution. I think it's clear that virus continue to evolve despite what we can think about. And now we have at least four main subtypes of the Omicron variants, of which one, the so-called BA.1, is the most prevalent. And is about now has a prevalence of about 96% of all available genomes. So by using our system, we found the new subtypes which lacked three additional mutation spike, with a very prevalence, high prevalence in UK, becoming prevalent in Italy, but not recognized by standard nomenclature. So as you can see, these three mutations could have potentially a high impact. But what we discovered later, and we, of course, give a notice to the health authorities, that this was just a sequencing artifact. Because, and this is another important aspect, in order to sequence the genome of SARS-CoV-2, we can follow two different procedures. One is a kind of shotgun RNA sequencing, but this procedure is really more expensive. The other one is amplicon-based. So that is, we have some universal, I may say, primer set that are designed in order to amplify the entire genome. There is an international consortium that is called ARTIC, that adapted the primer following the evolution of the viruses, but we discovered that the version 4 of this primer set was unable to amplify this particular region. So this mutation was skipped, not before they were lacking, but because there was a gap in this region. So this is another important aspect to be considered, but because the so-called drop-off of primer amplicons is another important aspect to be considered in genomic surveillance, in the sense that the virus evolved and we can became unable to amplify some of the region of the virus, so we can lose some important piece of variation. So, last point of my presentation, the importance of open data. And this importance has been really stressed and highlighted in this pandemic period, where an unprecedented amount of data has been produced during the pandemic. So in order to follow the evolution of the virus, we just really need that all these data are made available. In order to push and promote this data sharing process, which is very important, the Commission, the EU Commission, launched an international initiative to promote data sharing and curation, and the so-called COVID-19 portal. The COVID-19 portal, and this has been coordinated by the European Infrastructure for Life Science, ELIXIR, and ELIXIR Italy run the Italian instance with the collaboration of several ELIXIR Italy members. And this, as you can see in these slides, provide access to a rich wealth of data, from sequence to expression data, to proteins, to structures, and to literature. And this is very important for accelerating research to face and fight this pandemic. You can see below the web address for this data portal. So to conclude, just few observations. The first and obvious observation is that comparative genomics is a very powerful tool for studying and understanding evolution. Sequencing of the genomes gave us the possibility to identify and monitor the arise of dangerous and aggressive form of the virus. But as I told you before, it's important to put attention on the homogeneity of sampling. And we indeed are faced of limited and geographically and temporally based data. New variants with advantageous mutation are fixed very rapidly and can emerge everywhere, depending on the extent of virus circulation. And of course, this is another aspect to be considered. Even if we have a decreased level of hospitalization, a decrease of ICU, intensive care units occupancy, if the virus circulation is high, new variants can always and ever emerge. So it's really important that the vaccination campaign is completed, because it's indeed a very important shield against the pandemic. And the final point is we need genomic surveillance more than ever, because for this continuous circulation of the virus that we think will become endemic in a few weeks, but still we need to monitor what will happen in the coming weeks and months. And this also means that each country should have well-equipped facilities, infrastructure, and skilled personnel to, you know, carry out this surveillance in the most effective and efficient way. So to conclude, I would like to thank people collaborating to this project, which has been done mostly by Matteo Chiara in Milan, with the great work of Erica Ferrandi and the other colleagues of the Beacon Group in Milan, collaborating with me on this issue. And just to summarize what I said before, I would conclude with this words of Sun Tzu that warn us about our enemy. So we need to know both our enemy and ourselves in order to make victory sure. If we don't know the enemy and we don't know ourselves, we of course will succumb to every battle. And so with this, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Graziano. Thank you for the beautiful lecture. I ask the audience for a question to Graziano. We have time. So as usual, you can type your question in the chat or raise your hand and open the mic.
May I start with a very general question? May I?
Please. Yes, of course.
Okay, so... At the beginning, you mentioned that in principle, this virus codes for some 30 proteins, and 16 are whatever they are, horse, and they are superimposed, etc. Now, did we know at all if there are other proteins in the virus that are really important in order to develop the malady, or that they are, you know, somehow involved also in the pandemic, or I don't know, question.
Thanks, Rita, for the question. Indeed, it's very interesting. This is interesting for two reasons. One is that all the attention of scientists has been focused only on the spike protein in the first instance. But we know, and there is a growing literature that tell us that other proteins may be relevant, both for the immune response, for instance, the N protein or other proteins, which are on the surface of the virus, and which are as well important for the elicitation of the immune response. In fact, now are under investigation new vaccine which address not only the spike, because what we know now is that the region of the spike which bind the receptor evolve very rapidly, so is very prone to immune escape. So probably a vaccine multitasking, which is directed with other more conserved, less prone to mutation region, could be a good idea. And many people are working on this. So the question is very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And let's hope for the best. Now, students, my students, where are my students?
And all the audience, of course.
I cannot, you know, ask for questions. Where are my students? Still sleeping or what? Hello to everybody.
May I?
Yes, you may.
Oh, there is a question in the chat. Are these approaches that you just explained used also for monitoring other viruses?
Yes, of course, yes, because the procedure can be applied as well also to the evolution of other viruses, because what we did can be easily scaled up to other genomic surveillance issues. So, of course, this is a general feature of the bioinformatics tool we devise that can be scaled up to other problems. Of course, these are mostly addressing virus evolution because they have really very high rate, but they can be just used for other viruses as well.
But it is the first time we have such monitoring.
Yes, yes. For... Of course, this is after the so-called Spanish flu. After one century, we had this pandemic. Before
oh,
we did not experience the need to do this. Also yeah. Because this is really, for comparative genomics, was we can compare million and million of homologous sequence. It was really an unprecedented situation.
So how is the situation in other countries that are not European or North American countries for the monitoring? Are there initiatives, I don't know, in China, for example?
Of course, as you may understand,
sorry.
As you may know, in China, we don't know too much what happened.
But still, we don't know anything.
What I can tell you is, for instance, it's very interesting, the situation in Africa, because in Africa, we have a vaccination rate, which is very low. But notwithstanding this, we don't have very severe clinical outcome. Of course, we cannot know how many infections have been there, because I suppose that probably we have one or four, perhaps two order of magnitude higher. But as we know very well, most of infected people are asymptomatic or quasi symptomatic. And in Africa, in order to notice something, quasi symptomatic is not enough. But what I may say that probably, and this was already demonstrated in other studies, the immune system of African population is probably stronger than ours. This is demonstrated by the low incidence of autoimmune disease in Africa. And is because they have environmental exposition also to other agents that instruct the immune system much better than ours. So this probably is the reason why we didn't have a disaster in Africa.
Thank you. There are a couple of questions in the chat and the media. Emilio, maybe you can open the microphone.
Okay, I can do the question if you will. So I have a curiosity. So at some point, also people try to investigate the relationship between the pandemic and the variation that each one of the human beings carry out. Is there any data about the possibility that some human mutation can make the disease more strong or have more effect to a particular subtype of the population, given some mutation in some gene? Have been these data somehow collected?
Yes, yes.
Because you are doing sequencing, but you don't know the person that is carrying out this disease. Maybe this could be interesting.
Yes, thank you. Thanks, Emilio. Yes, of course. In fact, we are involved in another big international project that is called COVID-HGA, Human Genetic Effort, which is collecting exome data from hundreds of people, which are stratified in different groups that are the so-called resistant, the so-called sensible, and the so-called neutral. And also, this effort is going further in order to analyze genetic feature of people which are reinfected after the vaccination. So what is clear is that there is a clear genetic effect. For instance, there are some mutations, and some papers have been published, that have in common sensible people. So there is a genetic predisposition to severe form of the disease. My group sequenced about 250 exomes from these two classes. We were able to find some of these, successibility mutations, but much less lucky in finding resistant mutations. But this is a study which is in progress, so we hope to go further in this. And also, we don't have now evidence to find what we called breakthrough infection, that is the infection of vaccinated people. So of course, there is a genetic component. Probably genetic is not enough, but there is a clear genetic component, and also the outcome of the disease, which different forms is linked to genetic blueprint. For instance, forms of long COVID as linked to genetic blueprint of the affected people. So I just talked about the virus, but we have some interesting data on this. But as I told you before, we have just 250 genome exomes, but probably we need to analyze some thousand exomes in order to find something that is really statistically significant.
So there is a couple of questions in the chat. What is there in the viruses that maintain stability of proteins after mutating so much?
This is the forces of evolution that, of course, are interested in maintaining some features. So when we talk about evolution, that is balance between innovation and conservation, of course, the conservation needs to guarantee that virus propagates. And of course, there are forces that need to conserve what is relevant to guarantee the propagation of the virus. This is the basis of evolution.
Then another question from Sarah Hoff. Is it possible or impossible to develop an algorithm from the collected data from sequences, an algorithm to predict what will be mutated and therefore predict whether it will be more dangerous or not?
is not easy in the sense that what we can call the mutation space include virtually an infinite number of mutations. What we can learn from what we observe, so we can predict that some sites are more prone to accept mutation than others, but the precise constellation of mutation, in my opinion, is not so easy. So it's not predictable, I may say, because one thing is to say this site is more prone to mutation or not, but to establish the constellation of mutation that arose together to form a new variance, to my knowledge, this is not feasible at the moment.
Okay, Maria Giulia Prado can open the microphone.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, perfectly.
Okay, sorry if I am not turning on the camera, but I can't at the moment. Okay. So thank you for the presentation. It was very clear and very informative. I have a question. I was reading an article that was saying an hypothesis of the people with immunocompromised people acting as a human reservoir for the possible mutation because the virus is lurking in those people more time and it has the time and the possibility to mutate and to evolve in humans. So do you think that this could be possible or it could be a concern to the, because it could lead to the generation of potentially dangerous mutation that has the possibility to evolve in an environment, in a human environment, so more targeted.
Thank you. The question is clear. Of course, the possibility that new variants emerge are strictly correlated to the circulation rate of the virus. Of course, if a person is immunocompromised, the virus can circulate much more in this person and can be, of course, find new strategies to evade the low immune response. So this is possible. And there are also some studies that demonstrated that the use of serum from infected people was not so effective just because it could cause an effect like the one that you describe. Mm-hmm. Because in this case, if you expose the virus to exogenous antibodies, you provide the virus the possibility to escape better, and so it's not a good thing. So of course we can, should aim to decrease the circulation, to decrease the arise of new variants. This is the only way to pursue.
Okay, very clear. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Other questions? If not, I thank Razzano very much for the lecture, for the beautiful lecture, for the very clear lecture. I thank all the attendants for participating to the school. This was the last lecture of the school. So I want also to thank all the people that collaborated in maintaining and organizing the school. So Dr. Giulia Babbi, Giovanni Badeo, Matteo Manfredi, e Castenza Savoiardo, and of course, Rita Caledio for organizing it. The recordings of the school will be available in some day. We have to edit it and to upload on our website. So let you know what is the website. And also, if you need a certificate for attendance, please write us. We will check for your attendance to the lecture and we will provide, if possible, a certificate. So thank you very much to everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ciao. Ciao. Ciao, ciao, tutti. Ciao, ciao.